The Black Christian Nationalist Creed. I believe that human society stands under the judgment of one God, revealed to all and known by many names. His creative power is visible in the mysteries of the universe, and the revolutionary Holy Spirit will so not long permit men to endure injustice, nor to wear the shackles of bondage. In the rage of the powerless when they struggle to be free, and in the violence and conflict which even now threaten to level the hills and the mountains, I believe that Jesus, the Black Messiah, was a revolutionary leader sent by God to rebuild the Black nation Israel and to liberate Black people from powerlessness and from the oppression, brutality, and exploitation of the white Gentile world. I believe that the revolutionary spirit of God embodied in the Black Messiah is born anew in each generation, and that Black Christian nationalists constitute the living remnant of God's chosen people in this day, and are charged by him with responsibility for the liberation of Black people. I believe that both my survival and my salvation depend upon my willingness to reject individualism, and so I commit my life to the liberation struggle of Black people and accept the values, ethics, morals, and program of the Black nation defined by that struggle and taught by the Black Christian Nationalist Movement.
We're going to continue with the Gnostic Gospels. Last week we kind of ended up talking about those struggling for power, those with power are struggling to keep it, and those without power are struggling to get it. Right. And that's the kind of world that we live in today. That's the kind of world that existed in the New Testament, in the early New Testament times. And then I thought about some of the stuff that we talked about last week, and I reviewed the tape a little bit, and I said, well, you know, I think I gave these white people a little pass. You know, I don't think we talked about it just enough so we can understand, you know, what it is we're dealing with, what we're up against, and who our enemy is, like right. Brother Malcolm taught us, who he defined who the enemy was.
Right.
And you know, I don't know if I clearly outlined that. I know I was in a meeting a few weeks back, and one brother said that we were talking about the black slate, and he mentioned that we may not ought to be too black. You know, we might need to filter what we post on the black slate website and the black slate Facebook. So, you know, he may have a point there, but I didn't know we were, you know, trying to filter being black around here. I guess when I see white people trying to filter being white, then I say we ought to filter being black.
Right.
You
know?
But until then, I don't see the need in doing it.
Amen.
You know, yeah, we get a few donations from her from time to time, but, you know, you can't give up your soul for that.
Well.
You know, so in that spirit, I'm going to start out with a quote from Dr. Frances Cresswell, ISIS paper. She said that most white people hate black people. The reason that most white people hate black people is because white people are not black people. If you know this about white people, you need know little else. If you do not know this about white people, virtually everything else that you know about them will only confuse you.
Amen.
So, we need to understand that. Black people need to understand that. If they understood that, then they wouldn't be so bent out of shape when white people let them know that you're black and that we're white.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we still, to this day, have a hard time when white people tell us that they're white and we're black and that we're not one in Christ.
Well.
You know, we've run around and we've been taught this gospel that we all Americans, we're one in Christ, and we all gonna, you know, be brothers and sisters in Christ and all this. And but, you know, they every now and then, I guess once a month, once a week, however it happens, whenever they show it on the film, when they capture something, they let us know that white people are white people, and then we are black people, and they see a distinct difference.
Well, make it plain.
You know, now, we can run around and not see the difference, but they clearly see a distinct difference. Well, that's the kind of world that the first century CE was, when we're dealing with the Gnostic Gospels, when we're dealing with the teachers of Jesus, what grew out of the teachers of Jesus, the Jerusalem church, and the Gnostic Christians. That's the kind of world they lived in. The Romans clearly let them know that they were a white group, right, and that the Jews, the black nation Israel were a black group. There was no distinction. They clearly made a difference. I mean, there was a distinction. They clearly showed there was a difference in the way they interacted in those policies.
All right.
So that's the world that they live in. The first century CE was the beginning of direct white Roman rule.
That's right.
One of the most turbulent times of the black nation Israel. This period ended with the destruction of the temple and the partial destruction of the city Jerusalem in 70 CE. The total destruction and complete destruction came in 135 CE. Mm-hmm. Jesus, the black Messiah, lived during some of these violent periods. And he witnessed many of the atrocities committed by the white Romans that were in power.
All right.
The main issue that they were dealing with was taxation. The Roman had began to take a census of the population and to draw up an inventory of the resources of that country for the purpose of taxation. Many black Jews joined the Zealot movement as a response to the oppression and exploitation of the white Roman world. So we hear about the census in the New Testament, but people water it down and they think that they just, you know, it was like just filling out a census today that the government sent out every now and then.
Well,
just telling what's it, how many people are in the household, you know, fill out a box or how much income is in the household. You know, not nothing too threatening, you know. You have to give up too much information, but just check a few boxes and let them know, you know, for their representation. But the census in the New Testament was all about taxation and how much taxes we're going to extract from you.
Okay.
When we're gonna, if you growing tomatoes and you know make $50 on tomatoes, we want 25 of them.
Well,
if you growing melons and you make $500, we want $250 of them.
Well,
this census was threatening. This census was all about taxation, and they knew it. They knew what it was about, and the black nation Israel had a serious problem with it because they knew what it meant in terms of their wallet, in terms of their pocket. And we have to understand that the New Testament era has watered and filtered a lot of this out of the Bible. So you can't just pick up the Bible and get that. You have to get it from other extra-biblical information.
That's right.
So we have another quote from the book Jesus and the Zealots. A lot of people don't realize that Jesus was a zealot, and he even had some of his disciples were zealots.
Well,
you know, and so that's glossed over in the Bible.
That's right.
They said, that just mean that they were zealous for the Lord. You know, they were just zealous for God. Yeah, they were zealous for God, but they were also zealous for getting the black, the Romans off their back.
Well.
And that was the main thing that they were zealous about.
Make it plain.
How are they going to get these white people off their back? Get the yoke off their neck. Mm-hmm. Zealotism was essentially a popular movement embodying both religious and social aspirations and resentments of the people of the land. And that brings us to, basically, that brings us to BCN teachers number 7. Uh-oh. The spirituality of African people encompasses the totality of life.
Well.
Politics and economics are sacred because they offer programmatic mechanism for our struggle against white oppression.
That's it.
We know these were black people because they are struggling against their oppression.
Well.
We know that they didn't have a problem mixing in spirituality, politics, economics, and struggle. They had no problem with this whatsoever. So we know the Zealots were a black group, and we know they're dealing with African spirituality because they didn't make, some people won't say, oh, well, it's not, you know, right to struggle for power, it's not right to struggle for independence, but African spirituality didn't say that. It was about a religious institution that had to deal with all aspects of life. Well, and if you were oppressed, then your religion needs to be dealing with your oppression.
That's right.
You know, so we're going to move on. It would be important to remember this aspect of zealotism when we come to evaluate the attitudes of Jesus and his disciples towards it. Both Jesus and his disciples were of the people of the land. And the recorded teachings of Jesus vividly reflect the attitudes of the poor towards those who wore soft clothing, ate good food, and dwelled in kings' houses.
Well,
Pontius Pilate was particularly detested by the Jews and described him as naturally inflexible and stubbornly relentless.
All right.
And accused him of acts of corruption, insults, rampant outrages on the people, arrogance, repeated murders of innocent victims, and constant and most galling savagery. This is the world that the New Testament started out in. This is the world that grew through the first century CE. This is the world that the Gnostic Christians, the Jerusalem Church, had to come into being.
All right.
So we have to understand that we get mixed up a lot of times. Black Christians get mixed up because, you know, you take out the New Testament and you try to understand, they want to understand who Jesus is, what did Jesus do, what did he teach, what did he believe, you know, how did he believe about salvation? Did he believe salvation for all? Did he believe that he came to die for mankind's sin? Did he have a virgin birth? Did he resurrect on the third day? All these questions come up in the New Testament. And all these questions are answered in the Bible, but from a white perspective.
Well,
they answer from the white perspective after Christianity has been corrupted and taken to Rome, white Rome. So we're saying that in the Gnostic Gospel, which is the period that we're studying, the black nation Israel didn't agree with some of these ideas. These ideas were foreign to them. And it was a constant battle, it was a constant struggle.
Yeah.
You know, there are different conceptions of Jesus, whether we realize it or not. I know a lot of these black Christian nationalists here, revolutionary, y'all know different conceptions of Jesus, you know. But there are different conceptions of Jesus, one black and one white. And we have to understand how did these different conceptions come about, and that's what we're trying to deal with in the Gnostic teachings. With the significance of the Nag Hammadi Library discovered in December 1945, named after a town in Upper Egypt, there is now evidence of existence of many other gospel narratives concerning the life of Jesus. That is, other than the four biblical gospels.
All right.
And, you know, the Bible limits us to four gospels.
That's right.
But there are many others. Much of the content indicates the existence of many Christians who had radically different cosmology and Christology than those we have been handed down from European Christian church. The Gnostic documents were translations made in about 350 AD, we call it CE, made from more ancient documents. The original narratives are believed to have been written from around as early as 50 AD to as late as 150 AD. The library included 52 texts which remained after some had been burned, which make up 13 codices, and the collection included many of the early gospels that we have listed here.
All right.
Now this is just a small list of the gospels. Right. You can get books about the gospels, and there'll be just as many gospels in that book as you have books in the Bible. So all these gospels are just some indication of that there was a different conception of Christianity.
Yes.
There was a different conception of the teachings of Jesus. Now we have to understand and we have to realize that we're Christians, we call our Christians today, but they really didn't call themselves Christians today. That's just a Greek term for a Messiah. Mm-hmm. Now, they believe in the Messianic movement, and that's what they thought they were doing.
All right.
So we have to understand that the Gnostic Gospels reflect a lot of these different views that existed during this time. This is 1st century A.D. C.E. This is the 1st century years after Jesus' black Messiah had been crucified. So you have the Gospel of Thomas. And the Gospel of Thomas is simply a collection of sayings of Jesus. Now these Gospels predate, the Gospel of Thomas predate the Gospels in the Bible.
Okay.
You know, now why are they not in the Bible?
Uh-huh.
If they were written before the Gospels in the Bible. Well, we're gonna try to discover that and get into that a little later. You have the Gospel of Philip,
uh-huh.
which is a collection of Christian Gnostic teachings in the form of parables and narrative dialogues. You have the Gospel of Truth, discourse on the truth of the resurrection of Jesus and how this event helped them become aware of their source, of their being. Now, some of the, and there in the gospel, they're trying to deal with the inner divinity that we talked about, the inner divinity a lot in the nation.
Right.
So the Orthodox Christians, which became to be the Universal Church, which became to be the Roman Catholic Church, they want to talk about, you know, man's separation from God and that man separates from Jesus and there's no connection there. But in the Gospel of Truth and in the Gnostic Gospel, they talked about you can be all Jesus can be.
Well,
you have that same potential. There's nothing unique about him than you other than his commitment,
right.
other than him willing to see right. out the power of God, other than him willing to practice communalism and you practicing individualism.
Well,
those are the only differences between Jesus. Jesus was willing to give up his total life. And any brother that's willing to give up his total life for his people will come upon the experience of God.
Well,
you know, but you just got to give up that commitment.
Teach, brother, teach.
The Gospel of the Egyptians was a text about the spiritual power of man and woman and the light within. You know, because in the Gospel of the Egyptians, they didn't just, you know, a lot of the Bible were male dominated, showed his book, you know, they don't talk a lot about women. You know, but the Gospel of the Egyptians, you know, they talked about the spirit of woman and the spirit of man.
All right.
So you better get you a copy of that. You had the secret book of James. This is a letter about the resurrection that Jesus gave to James and Peter after the resurrection. And the resurrection was a source also of contention between the Gnostic Gospels and the what became to be the Orthodox Catholic Christians.
All right.
You know, there was a source of contention. Was this resurrection a physical, bodily resurrection, or was it something else? So that's what your debate is in the secret books of James. Then you have the Gospel of Ebionites, which denies the virgin birth altogether. That book just straight out denies the virgin birth and say, you know, if you believe that Jesus rose physically, then you just, you know, you're drunk, you're intoxicated
well.
With all this crazy teachings that are around here. Then you have the Gospel of the Nazarenes, which are very similar to the Gospel of Matthew. Yeah, like the Gospel of Matthew, the Nazarene follows almost the same flow, you know, but it doesn't mention a virgin birth as well.
All right.
You know, it does have something about this resurrection at the end, but it's very similar. So you got a lot of Gospels out there. Then you have the Acts of Andrews and the Acts of Thomas, both dealing with the events that followed the resurrection or the death, the execution of Jesus.
All right.
Then you have the Gospel of Mary.
Well.
Which is a book that deals with the leadership role, confronting the disillusionment disciples had after the execution of Jesus. She also gave special teachings that she said she had from Jesus. Now this is Mary Magdalene, and this is a source of contention for the Catholic Church, for the early Church, for the Orthodox Church, because they did not believe that Mary Magdalene should be, you know, a disciple per
well.
Se. They did not believe that she should be, you know, mentioned with all the other brothers. All right. You know, they got, you know, certain things in the Bible about Mary. You know, I guess she was good with the men or something. So they don't like to mention her. But this book also deals is a book dealing with the role of women in the church. You can see why the Roman Catholic Church eventually rejected the Gospel of Mary, because they didn't want to say that women should have leadership roles in the church. Well, you know, still to this day, they don't believe in letting a woman come up and be the Pope. Can't be a woman Pope in the Catholic Church. I think you can be a woman Jeremiah and try. You know, yeah, but I think you can be. You know, we might need to try that. You know, it'd be a beautiful thing, you know. But that Gospel of Mary was a source of contention in the early Christian movement between the Gnostics and what the Orthodox Christian, which came to be the Catholic Church, because that role with women being, because you know, they, men say, look, women, they're not of God. They're not spiritual like men. You know, they're supposed to be barefoot and pray. Well. You know, that was a big struggle with them, and we all know why that book was rejected.
Well, all right.
Somebody help me with the reading of that quote there from the Gnostic Gospel by Elaine Pagels.
Others saying in this collection criticize common Christian belief, such as the virgin birth or the bodily resurrection, as naive misunderstanding. It has been suggested that the collection of saying in the Gospel of Thomas may include some traditions even older than the Gospels of the New Testament, possibly as early as the second half of the first century, 50 to 100, as early as or earlier than Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John, the Gospel of Mark.
So in the Gnostic Gospels, you know, the author's clearly stating that, you know, these writings predate the what we have in the Bible. You know, what we have in the Bible is somewhat of a distortion. Even some of the earlier books in the Bible are not at the beginning. Like even some of the letters of Paul predate some of the Gospels.
Well.
But they want you to believe the way the Bible is laid out, that Matthew was first, then Mark was second, then Luke, and all that. You know, because they're trying to set up something.
Amen.
They're trying to set up a particular ideology. So you have to put the books in such a kind of way where it would conform to that ideology. So we must always remember that the New Testament that we have is copies of copies of copies.
Amen.
So there's no original New Testament books that we have.
Well,
they're copies of copies of copies.
All right.
And if you have copies of copies,
well,
you can do what to them? You can edit them. You can change them.
That's right.
You can redact them. You can do whatever you want to them and then put it in a book and say, this has always been in there, and this is the teachings of the Lord.
Well.
And if you don't know that the teachings of the Lord has been edited,
well,
then you think that edited teachings of the Lord is the teachings of the Lord, but it's actually the teachings of somebody else.
Well.
So these Gnostics and the Zealots, the Baptists, the Essenes, the Nazarenes, all these are considered pre-Christian or early Christian movements. All these, you know, movements became to be outcasts, heretics, and the teachers of Paul became to be the rule of them.
Well,
you know, it's right. Like a reverse of the inversion of the reality.
Okay.
The Apostle Paul, which never knew Jesus, his teachers are considered the rule of thumb, and the teachers from the Gnostics, the Pharisees, the Zealots, the Essenes, all those are heretical writings.
Well.
So we have a complete inversion of the Bible. And it should be, we should clearly state that out. So that's why it's important to do Bible study. That's why it's important to do New Histories, New Testament study, so we can set all this up properly, so
well,
we have the right conceptions
that's
of
right.
what it is all about. Because all this confused people, and then, you know, when we try to do seeking, when we try to get into spirituality, when we try to get closer and we try to get into the inner workings of each other, and it just creates a whole bunch of problems, because everybody is just block, because these teachers will block you.
Well,
they will block you from God.
Go ahead.
You know, and we have to unblock each other so we can get to God.
That's right. Man. Teach, bro.
So these there was a constant struggle between the Gnostics, the early Christians, and the Orthodox Christian Church, which became to be the Catholic Church, and that needed to be understood. And some of that is in the Bible. If you take the Matthew, which we mentioned, Mark and Luke, Matthew has a virgin birth and Mark doesn't. Well, how did that happen? Well, obviously, there's a struggle going on, and they said, well, we can't take this out because we'll lose all kind of credibility. Mm-hmm. You know, like you take out certain teachers, then everybody, well, that's not even valid no more because they've taken this out. So you have Matthew with the virgin birth, Luke with a virgin birth, but you have Mark that doesn't have one.
Okay.
Then you have Mark that doesn't even have a resurrection story at the end. If you have your Jerusalem Bible, you'll see there's a footnote that says that this was added later. I clearly stated that in the Bible. So that struggle is going on, you know, and we have to understand, you know, what that was all about.
That's right.
One of the critical events between the Gnostics and the early Catholic Church was the resurrection. You know, what is salvation all about? How are you saved? And did Jesus have a virgin birth? So that's the struggle that's going on. And you know eventually who won.
That's right.
You know, so we have all these different things that are in the Bible. So we have a quote here also from the first Christians was a magazine that came out some years ago, because I was talking to the money other one day. He was trying to, I think he said something about how did Christianity go from here and way over, you know, become the world religion. So there it is for you, Demani. Somebody read that for Demani.
The early Christians' message was not a uniform creed. It changed in important ways, especially in its depiction of Jesus, as Christianity spread from Black Palestine to the White Roman Empire.
So it wasn't uniform. You know, when the black nation of Israel was destroyed in 70 AD, 70 CE, and the Jerusalem church came about, and then they eventually got dispersed, you know, there were a lot of groups with various different gospels, right, with various different beliefs. Right. And a lot of these beliefs changed and evolved and moved to different states as it moved from Black Palestine, Black Jerusalem, Black Israel, to White Rome.
All right.
So if we understand that, then you can start to understand why the Bible is the way it is and why some of these books were not selected to go in the Bible.
All right.
I know Jakuma, he did a few weeks ago, he gave a list of all these books and he talked about, you know, I love that example, you know, you had all the books on the altar and, you know, they said a prayer and everybody left the meeting. And then they came back on the altar and there was only a few books there. You know? And those books became to be your Bible.
That's right.
You know, so that's important, and that's about how it happened. Yeah. You know, that's about the selection. Of course, they knew what was in those books. They knew they had, well, can't deal with the Gospel of Mary. Sure. We don't want no parts of that. Mm-hmm. Can't deal with the Gospel of Thomas. You know, he said something about God and is within and all that. We can't deal with that. You know, we can't deal with the Ebonites and Nazarenes, all that. Well, but we can accept Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. That fits into what we're trying to do. We can control, and we can control the people. That we can't control the people if they thinking they got the power of God in them.
Well.
We can't control them that way. You gotta let them know that there's a distinctness between you and God.
Well.
You know, so that was a good one. That's for the money, and you know, but that was a drastic departure from the original theological framework of the Jerusalem Church.
Go ahead.
Beginning with the ministry of Paul and the conception of being called personally, his conception of being personally called by Jesus, not God, to be an apostle to the Gentiles. Paul clearly states
that I am a apostle to the Gentiles.
That's right.
Now, yeah. we can play semantics and say the Gentiles are people without faith, and you don't have any faith in the Yahwehism or the teachings of God, then you're a Gentile. But the Gentiles are white people. That's right.
Make you white.
Make you white. That's something that come about later.
That's right.
Oh, the Gentiles are, you know, people who don't believe. But in first century CA, the Gentiles were white Romans.
Right.
And all these other groups that were there oppressing the black nation Israel.
Amen.
So we have to understand that as
Make
well.
Plain, brother.
If we want to understand the Gnostic gospel, the Gnostic gospels are important because they give us a different conception of Jesus.
Well.
They give us a different conception of who Jesus was. Can we come upon that spiritual power? Is it available to all? Is it just available to him? Was it bestowed on him at his birth? Or was it bestowed on him at his baptism? The gospel of the Gnostic gospel answers that question.
All right.
And we need to study those.
Amen.
Somebody read that other quote. That's from the BCN Bible Study reference book.
These gospels were denounced as heresy in the middle of the second century by Western Christians, prior to Rome's acceptance of Christianity. Yet, by the 4th century, after Constantine's conversion, the documents were officially confiscated and denounced as heretical, even to the point of being declared a criminal offense. Mm. These gospels were burned. The Orthodox Christians of today are those who, by 200 AD, had forcibly become the institutional church, denouncing all views other than those held by them. They insisted there could only be one church, which would be defined by their hierarchy of bishops, priests, and deacons. And this would be Orthodox and must become the Catholic universal view of the expanse of all other Christian views.
So, by the time this came around, it eventually got to a point to where if you're caught with any gospels other than Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we're going to, it was a criminal offense. It was a criminal offense, you know, and, you know, back during that days when the Romans said it was a criminal offense, that meant what? That meant death. That meant execution on the cross. You know, that you can sit there and say, no, I'm not with this, they just happened to be in my car. No, you got it. You must believe it. Huntsman's pilot want to see you. But this was a serious issue. When you're trying to create power, when you're trying to control people's mindset and people thinking, you can't allow other thoughts to creep in.
Well.
You can't allow other ideologies to creep in. You got to say, this is what we believe, this is what we're going to follow, this is what we're going to teach. Everything else is heretical.
Okay.
And that's what they did. And lo and behold, if we find you with this other stuff, you know, that's going to be the end. But there were a lot of people who said, well, I'll take death because I believe in this. I know Jesus didn't rise on the third day. And if I got to go down for that, then I have to go down. So there was a battle. It was intense.
Uh-huh.
It was real. It was crucial. It was critical. It was serious. It was life and death battle that existed. It's been smoothed over in the Bible. You can hardly pick it up. There might be 3 or 4 scriptures in there that gives you an indication that there was a struggle, intense struggle going on. This was a serious time. It was a violent period. It was not a time where, you know, you could just play around and pretend you're of one thing and you're not of another. It was real, and you had to decide what side you were on.
All right.
And that's the period of the Gnostic gospel. So we're going to close or end up with this other quote from Black Christian Nationalism. We are Black Christian Nationalism. Somebody read that other one for me.
We have 2 beasts to fight, the beast within and the beast without. To neglect one is as dangerous as to neglect the other. and to misunderstand one is as dangerous as to misunderstand the other.
And that's Black Christian nationalism in that chapter, Yaakov Miller. That's important. Now, we talk a lot about the white man, you know, like I intentionally tried to throw the white man on the bus today. You know, I don't know if I did enough, but that's, we have a beast. We have two beasts. We got a beast without, and we also have the beast within.
That's right.
Every thought that comes to your mind is not the right thought. Every idea that you come up with is not the right thought. Some of your individualism is destructive to what we need to do as a people.
That's
so that we have to deal with the white man on the outside, and we have to deal with our individualism on the inside.
Make it plain.
To neglect one is just as worse than neglect the other. And we've neglected the white man for years. You know, and we've also neglected our individualism.
Well.
You know, we have to deal with that. We have to check people's individualism. We have to check people's ideas that are not conforming or conducive to building a Black nation.
Well,
that's the only way. We don't have power. So we can't have all these various different ideas and views and all that. We got to say, have one particular view, and this is the view we're going to stand on. This is the view we're going to build on. And once we get power, then we can allow other views.
Well,
you know, we can allow Democrats and Republicans. Who's in office? Because we have power. We can allow people to protest. It don't mean nothing. We still have the power. The white man still has the power. So when you have power, you can allow some of these, you know, views to take place.
Well,
you remember back in the 60s, white people didn't feel as secure in their power. They, we can't have all this protest. We can't have all this march. We can't have this demonstration. You know, they were serious about it, but now they almost care less because they know their power is solidified.
Well,
you know, so we have to understand that. We have to understand there's a beast within and there's a beast without. We have to deal with this beast within.
Well,
we have to deal with the beast without. We have to spend days on the beast without. We have to spend days talking about the beast within.
That's right.
The beast is real.
Uh-huh.
The beast within is real. You know, individualism is real. We have people that are individualistic.
That's right.
And unfortunately, that's the white world's view. There's no way to come into the church and come into the Black nation without being individualistic. You are individualistic by nature.
Well,
you know, and when you come into the nation, we have to, well, that's individual. I know you want to go to the mall and shop. You know, but we got something we need to do more important. We need to go up to Beulah. I know you got to go on a date and all this, but we got something more. We got to plant some seeds. You know, all this kind of stuff, you know, but you have to confront it. But without a group, without a strong group, it's difficult to do that. And so everybody does their own thing.
All right.
And when everybody's doing their own thing, you got a chaotic situation.
Tell the truth.
We're going to continue on with the Gnostic Gospel.